When I did this, I was 5 years old, and I meant for you to enjoy it. And every time it's been played for the last 28 years, people laugh. And I just wanted you to know before you heard it that this little girl meant to do a good job for you. Okay?
Disposition. He could be hurt, but I never did see him throw a temper, be control of any kind. He's always cool. And one thing that I'll always remember, Uncle Clyde got down Granddad's old muzzle-loading double-barrel shotgun. And he put a heck of a charge in that thing, and he chewed newspaper and stamped in there a whole mess of it, and he put a charge of buckshot in it and tamped some more newspaper in there. Well, he went out to the corner of the smokehouse, he went to the southeast corner of the smokehouse, and he says, "See that granary down there?" Says, "I'm going to see how many shot that this thing will put in there." Well, he up and pulled that trigger. Well, Uncle Clyde was kicked clear around the corner of the building. Trigger guard cut his finger, and it wrapped this barrel around the other barrel. Of course, Grandpa seen that. He says, "You could have been killed." And that's all I heard of it. And another time, see, Claude and Clyde, there wasn't too much difference in age, I think, in the neighborhood of 2 years. We played together a lot. And Granddad had a buggy that he felt very much of. He'd get a bucket of water and wash that buggy. He washed that buggy as often as most people wash their cars, see? And we took the shavs out of this buggy, and there was an incline in the pasture. But at the foot of this incline, there was a ditch almost as deep as those tables and just wide enough for a buggy wheel to drop in. Well, we went down two or three times, and it was a pretty nice ride, you know? But this time, Uncle Claude lost the rope, and we hit that ditch. Of course, we went right over the dashboard, and the dashboard was bent over. Well, Grandpa was hurt, but he never said much. Really, Grandpa could control his temper better than any man I ever knew. And that's about all that satisfy you there.
something that happened in the past. We're going to kind of open this thing up a little bit now. We're going to talk about some people and bring up some things that you probably just soon not hear and be reminded of. But I think Alfred ought to kick this off. And I'd like for you to be thinking about some past experiences that are humorous or that might be interesting to the rest of the people here.
My first morning on the drill field in the Army, they had us in a line walking single file like a bunch of ducks going to water, you know. And there's a big tall guy in front. And the old sergeant got us, give us command at halt. And this old boy just walked way on out there, about 100 yards, just a strutting her off before he realized he was alone. Well, I laughed. And that sergeant got his nose right down my face, trying to make it clear to me that I wasn't at ease. You seen Gromer Pyle on the TV, well, that's what I thought of. And I laughed in his face. Well, he pulled me out there and made me stand at attention. It seemed like a half hour, but I guess it was just a few minutes. But there's one time something happened that I didn't laugh at. Art and I hunted ducks a lot, and we both used the same shotgun. And Dad was great to read. And we sitting there in the kitchen by the old cast iron cook stove. He had a wooden box he put his feet up on when he was reading. And I decided I was going out next morning, and I got the old shotgun and the oil can, and I oiled it a little and gave the old slide a jerk, bang. Cast iron was flying all over the kitchen. I looked up, I didn't see him, he had his feet in my face. That was one time I didn't laugh. At this time, I would like for Lucy to come up here.
Well, I tell you, one night me and my brother Leonard, I believe it was, sleeping downstairs, and my dad said, Lucy, get up. Someone in the hen house. So he said, you bring the lantern. So I got up and dressed, got the lantern back quickly as I could, and he took some matches and went on. So he just run up the hen house door and struck a match, and out come the old sow, run right between his legs. So I was going up the hill, and here he come down the hill on the old sow. So that's all I could tell you that happened right there.
Oh, Lord. You didn't tell him how he looked.
No, he was coming backwards.
He told me it looked like a boomer wagon coming down the path in the moonlight.
Grandpa Bishop was deathly afraid of horses. He never had any horses, and he wouldn't have one around the place unless it was an old plug horse that was so old and weak that it could hardly walk. And Dad was telling about, he decided that if they were ever going to do any farming, they better get some horses. So they bought some young colts, and when it came time to break them, why, Grandpa Bishop disappeared, and they found him hid under the bed. That's pretty hard to believe, but he just didn't like horses. And then my dad was deathly afraid of snakes, and every time they'd have a tornado coming or cyclone or they had to store anything in the cellar, it was always a big battle to get who's going to win, the snakes or them. And he just, he had a deathly fear of those snakes. But I think the thing that really impresses me about the memoirs that Dad wrote was Grandma Bishop, how she was the provider in that family, and how she planned her whole year out so that when a certain time of the year came, they had either some food on the table or something to sell, that they could get some money to sustain themselves in the way of clothes and things like that. She was probably the champion hen setter. And that may sound kind of funny to some of you, I don't know, but that was an art. And you had to know how to set an old hen to keep her to stay on the nest and make those eggs hatch so that eventually you'd have some meat on the table or something to sell to get some money later on to use. And she actually taught women. Women would come to her and she'd teach them how to set a hen. And that was, I mean, that sounds like a very small thing, but back in those days it was a very big thing. And she set turkey eggs with hens at a certain time of the year so that when those turkeys got to be a certain age, they could run them off to town and sell them and get some clothes for the kids to wear to school. They weren't raised so much for their own meat, but to sell for somebody else. And of course, all of the chickens, the roosters, Dad said after they got to be so old, they'd better run and hide, because if they didn't, they'd be meat on the table. But they were always doing something like that, planting the gardens at certain times and storing the food away and doing all those kinds of things so that they could survive. It must have been pretty tough. I know my dad said that it hadn't been for an Aunt Edith farm that they lived on for 35 years there north of Portland. He didn't know what they would have done, but she took them in and they stayed on that farm all that time. And we're able to survive. It's all very interesting to try to find out, you know, how people survived to get to the point they did so that you and I could be here today. It was all part of a master plan, I guess. Well, those are just some little anecdotes that I picked up about the past. I'd like to call on some of the rest of you to say something about your family or something that you know that might be interesting to everyone about the family and what they did. We'd like to have you come up here and tell us.
Back when Herschel was staying with Aunt Effie and Uncle John going to junior high, I wrote to Uncle John Hopper and Aunt Gertie and asked them if I came to see if I could get something out of their old trunk, Grandma Lydia's old trunk. And he said, well, I can have anything but the Bible, and that was supposed to go to Uncle Nudie's daughter, Hazel. And so I took some of those things and put them in the Cherokee Strip Museum there in Ark City. So if you're here long enough and want to go down to the Cherokee Strip Museum, you see Grandpa's stripes. He was a sergeant in the Civil War. And there's a hand woven headscarf that grandmother's mother made, and Grandmother Lydia's coin purse is there, and there's a copy of Grandpa's discharge from the Civil War there. So I just thought, anytime that you're around Ark City and want to go down to Cherokee Strip Museum, it was put in there because he helped these two boys take their claims, Nudie and John. And like he said, they had their racehorses, and they got on those, and when they shot the gun, well, they started, and they took their claims just, I think, about 2 miles west of Blackwell, and they had some nice claims there, but they weren't either one married yet. And Uncle Johnny, he said later, what if I just had Gertie then, I wouldn't have sold that, because they got oil on that land. And Gertie was a lot younger than him. She said, well, she was only 12 or something like that when he got that land there. But anytime you're around Ark City, go down Cherokee Strip and see some of those things. It's from the Hopper family.
We have three presents here that Claire has made himself. And I'll have Phyllis draw three numbers. Names, okay. Eleanor Enfield Martin. Gail White. Mary White. Feel, but I would like to hear Iva's record played when we could hear.
Little girls, Evie and Myrtle, and he joined up with some folks going to Oregon by wagon and team, and they traveled to Oregon City. But they didn't stay long. They returned, and during those days there was, he just barely raked out a living. I lived with the bishops until I was 11 years old. Oh, he had a violin. Now, where he got this violin has always been a mystery. But it was a very fine Stradivarius. And I can remember that violin. I remember seeing it. It stayed in its box under the bed.
It belonged to Elsie Bishop Scott, and it came from the Golden Reel store of Elmer and Gladys Bishop. Elsie gave the bowl to Esther Mason, that's me, as a keepsake, and to replenish her bowls when they had the dinners at Esther's home. So I want to pass it on to you two people for coming this far. It's great having you.
Well, we appreciate, Esther, you thinking about us, and it was a little jaunt, but it wasn't that far. We had planned to come back anyway. I grew up in the wheat fields in Kansas, and the elevator, and I kind of wanted to come back one more time and go through a harvest, and so... Since my brother-in-law and sister-in-law raised wheat, and we hadn't seen them in a while, we decided that we'd come back and go through the wheat harvest and then attend the reunion at the same time. And I don't know, wheat harvest was a little more than I bargained for, I guess. But it's been a lot of fun. We always enjoy coming back because this is where we both went to school and visit people, and it's nice to see all of you and to be able to be here. This is a beautiful dish, Esther, and we really appreciate it, and we will treasure it. Apparently, it came out of the, probably came out of the candy counter in my dad's old grocery store there in Portland. I don't know, but that's china, she says, and it came from Germany. It's probably the only thing that we have that came out of that store, and we really appreciate it. We missed out on all the old property that came from that store, and we were always sorry. So we're very happy to have this dish, and thank you very much.
This is my father's favorite hymn. It's a little brown church in the mail. I might tell you why he liked it. In his home, he had a sister that played the little pump organ, you know, and after dinner on Sunday, they'd all gather around this pump organ and sing, and he always wanted to sing this song.
There's a church in the valley by the church in the
I wanted to not overlook this, because you're looking at the two workers in this group, and these two people, believe me, if it hadn't been for them, I don't know whether we would have had anything to eat or if this thing would even have been put on at all. Ernestine and JC have done a lot of work, and they deserve a lot of appreciation and thanks from us for all their efforts. And they've been back in the kitchen practically all day. And also thanks to George for all of his effort in putting that book together. And Betty, I know they spent a lot of hours on that, worked hard on it. And we thank them for that. And Esther and Ernest, of course, for all of their trouble and time. And they're really the ones that put this thing together. And I think...
And according to the program, this concludes the day. And it's been a wonderful day to me. I hope it has for you. I've got acquainted with some relations.